Hi everyone, this is Dr. Manu Krishnan K, and in today's session, we'll be discussing about the flexor retinaculum in detail, and we will also see what is carpal tunnel and how it is formed. So here in this diagram itself, you can see this is a cross section made at the level of the wrist joint here, and you can see a set of bones, isn't it? 1, 2, 3, 4. You can see 4 bones here. So there are a set of 8 bones which forms the wrist joint that is called as the carpal bones. So first we will see what are the carpal bones. Then we will see how this green color region, that is nothing but the flexor retinaculum, how it is formed. And we will see which are the structures which are passing below this particular flexor retinaculum. And here you can see a tunnel like space, right? And that tunnel is nothing but the carpal tunnel. So let's see everything in detail. The flexor retinaculum is a strong fibrous band which bridges the anterior concavity of the carpus, and it converts the same into a tunnel called as the carpal tunnel. What is carpus? The term carpus refers to the carpal bones. So we will see how the concavity is formed in the arrangement of the carpal bones. So first we have to listen to the names of the carpal bones, and then we will see the arrangement of these same bones. They are a set of 8 bones which are arranged in 2 rows, and there is a proximal row as well as a distal row, and each of them constitutes 4 bones. Okay, and the proximal row, when we consider lateral to medial, the first one is scaphoid, then we have lunate, tricuterale and pisiform bone, while in the distal row we have the trapezium, trapezoid, capitate and hamate bone. To remember these names, there is a mnemonic that we used to use, that is, she looks too pretty, try to catch her. The first letter of each word represents one bone from the carpal bone set. So the first one, S stands for scaphoid, L for lunate, tricuterale, T stands for tricuterale, P for pisiform, and in the distal row, again, T stands for trapezium, T for trapezoid, C for capitate and H for hamate. So I'll repeat the mnemonic. She looks too pretty, try to catch her. So all the first letters you have to segregate, and that defines the first letter of each of the carpal bones. So let's see the bones first. So here we have a representation of the carpal bones, and you can see how they are arranged. So we have, there is a proximal row here which is closer to the body, then we have a distal row. So we will see each of the bones. So starting from the proximal row, the first one from lateral towards the medial, we have to consider the first one, that is the scaphoid bone here. Then we have the lunate bone. Then we have the tricuterale bone. And at the end of the tricuterale bone, you can see a round small bone, right? That small bone overlying the tricuterale is nothing but the pisiform bone. So that defines the proximal row of carpal bones. Then we have the other one, that is the distal row. The distal row, again we will have to start from the lateral end, and that is the trapezium, the trapezoid bone, the capitate bone and the hamate bone. And the hamate itself will be having a hook-like projection which is projecting anteriorly, and that is termed as the hook of hamate. So I am just stressing on these points because there are some important attachments happening here, and that is nothing but the flexor retinaculum. So let's see the attachments of flexor retinaculum. Medially, the flexor retinaculum, the tough, strong band, is attached medially to 2 points, that is nothing but the pisiform bone and the hook of the hamate. So we have seen where the pisiform bone is located, above which we have seen the hook of the hamate as well. So these two are considered to be the medial attachments of flexor retinaculum. And laterally, it is attached to the tubercle of scaphoid and the crest of the trapezium. So here we have the scaphoid bone, and the tubercle of the scaphoid will be giving attachment for the flexor retinaculum laterally. And along with that, there is the crest of the trapezium bone, which is also giving attachment for the fibers of flexor retinaculum. So this is how the retinaculum is attached to either sides, and this is how it bridges the concavity. Now we have to see the concavity, right? So in the next picture, here we can see a cross-sectional image of the hand. You can see the hand, and we have taken a cross-section. a horizontal section through the wrist joint region. And you can see the cross section includes the four bones you can see here. And when we consider the flexor retinaculum, as I told you, it bridges between the concavity of carpus. So this particular concavity is termed as the concavity of carpus. The carpal bones are arranged in such a way that there is a central depression that is called as the concavity of carpus. So when a bridge is formed, that is by the flexor retinaculum above it, the whole concavity will be converted into a tunnel, and that tunnel is termed as the carpal tunnel. That's it. So we have the flexor retinaculum bridging the concavity, and there is a tunnel formed beneath it, that is the carpal tunnel. So let's see the structure of the flexor retinaculum. So the green color bridge which is formed between this concavity ends, you can see that how it stretches. And along with that, if you have a closer look, you can see two extra slips developing on either side of this particular retinaculum. So on the lateral side of retinaculum, you can see a deep slip going downwards and getting attached to the trapezium bone, while on the medial aspect we have a superficial slip which is lying superficially and getting attached to the pisiform bone. So these are the two extra slips formed in the flexor retinaculum, and as I told you, the deep slip will be forming a small triangular tunnel within this space. Between the flexor retinaculum and the deep slip, there is a triangular space through which the tendon of flexor carpe radialis will be passing. And on the other side, medially, we have another tunnel, or like a particular more superficial slip, which is forming, and it is inserted to the pisiform bone, forming a small canal here, and that is called as the volar canal or volar carpal ligament. This particular ligament overlying that canal is termed as volar carpal ligament, and this canal is termed as the volar canal, through which two structures will be passing, that is nothing but the ulnar nerve and the ulnar artery. So these are the things passing through the volar canal. So that defines the structure of flexor retinaculum. Then we have the relations of flexor retinaculum. We have to see which all structures are passing superficial to the retinaculum and which are the structures passing deep to it. So the first one is structures passing superficial to the retinaculum, which includes the tendon of palmaris longus. In the previous class on the superficial flexor compartment, we have seen the palmaris longus, and we have seen that it is getting attached to the distal part of the flexor retinaculum, and then it continues as the palmar aponeurosis, isn't it? So the tendon of palmaris longus is passing above the flexor retinaculum. Along with that, on either side of the tendon of palmaris longus, we have two small nerves which are passing into the superficial part of the palm, that is the palmar cutaneous branch of median nerve and the ulnar nerve. So that we'll be seeing in the next diagram. Then we have the ulnar vessels and nerve. Where it was passing? It was passing through the volar canal. And volar canal is formed by volar carpal ligament. So there was a ligament, just a superficial slip forming a small canal, that is the volar canal, through which two structures were passing, that is nothing but the ulnar vessels and the ulnar nerve. Then the structures passing deep to the flexor retinaculum are the median nerve, then the tendon of flexor digitorum superficialis and profundus, then the tendon of flexor pollicis longus, then we have some extension of the synovial sheath. Synovial sheaths are nothing but like connective tissue covering like the tendons of the compartment, the flexor compartment of forearm, and that will be extended into the palmar space, and they are called as the ulnar and radial bursa, that we'll be discussing later. So the ulnar and radial bursa will also be passing through the carpal tunnel or through the passage which is formed by the bridge formed by the flexor retinaculum. And along with that, the flexor carpe radialis tendon will be passing through a small tunnel formed by the deep slip of flexor retinaculum and the flexor retinaculum above it. So there is a triangular space. We have seen it right in the previous diagram. So the same things we will see with the help of a diagram. So we are going to see the carpal tunnel, the flexor retinaculum and the carpal bones here. So let's revise part by part. So we have the carpal bones here, which is forming a concavity of the carpus. So here you can see the concavity, which is bridged by the flexor retinaculum. So the part which I am just showing right now is the flexor retinaculum, and laterally it gives off a deep slip, which is going and inserting to the bone over here. Then we have a lateral, the medial superficial slip, which is going and inserting to the pisiform bone. Then we have to see the structures which are pertaining to the cavity or the tunnel, and the structures which are lying superficial to the flexor retinaculum. So we will see the superficial structures first, which are lying superficial to the flexor retinaculum. So the center one is nothing but the palmaris longus tendon, and on either side of palmaris longus tendon we can see some two small nerves, right, that are palmar cutaneous nerves of median nerve and the ulnar nerve. So these are the small palmar cutaneous branches which will be supplying the palmar skin. Then here is the volar canal, which is formed by the volar carpal ligament. This is the volar carpal ligament, or the superficial slip of flexor retinaculum, below which you can see two structures passing by. The red color represents the ulnar artery and the yellow represents the ulnar nerve. So these are the superficial structures passing over the flexor retinaculum. Now let's see what are the structures lying within the, just below the flexor retinaculum. So here you can see there are four tendons, four superficial tendons, that is nothing but the flexor digitorum superficialis tendons, and we have the deeper tendons, that is nothing but the flexor digitorum profundus. So what might be this pink color structure covering all these tendons? That is nothing but the synovial sheath, which I have discussed in the previous slide, the radial bursa and the ulnar bursa. So these are the bursae, like the synovial sheaths will be covering the tendons and keep them separate. It will prevent adhesion and it will just give freedom of movement. Then on the other side, on laterally, you can see a big nerve which is passing, that is nothing but the median nerve, and below you can see flexor pollicis longus. And here in this particular triangular space formed by the deep slip of flexor retinaculum and above flexor retinaculum, this is nothing but the flexor carpe radialis tendon. They are also covered by the synovial sheath. So these are the contents of flexor retinaculum, for contents which are lying below the flexor retinaculum, or you can say these are the contents of carpal tunnel. So we have seen what is flexor retinaculum, what is carpal tunnel, and now we will see what are the clinical anatomy of this particular arrangement. The important thing to remember is CTS, carpal tunnel syndrome. It's a very common kind of clinical anatomy that we'll come across in our daily practice. And here, the carpal tunnel is a narrow passageway surrounded by the bones and ligaments of the palmar side of hand. We have seen that. Bones, ligaments, then the tendons are all passing through this particular space. And this particular carpal tunnel syndrome is caused by the pressure on the median nerve due to the inflammation of synovial sheaths located within the tunnel. And when the median nerve is compressed, there will be symptoms like numbness, tingling sensation, and weakness of the hand, arm, and arm. So these are the common presentations of carpal tunnel syndrome. There will be weakness in gripping the objects, and sometimes there will be tingling sensation or numbness which is extending into the area which is supplied by the median nerve. So this concludes today's session on the flexor retinaculum and the carpal tunnel. Thank you.